path along life's highway. So common and well trod by the shoes of burdened Christians who won't put their trust in God.
Welcome to The Liberating Secret with your host, author, and teacher, Sylvia Pearce. The Liberating Secret is dedicated to revealing the mystery of the gospel, which is Christ in you, the only hope of glory. Let's join Sylvia Pearce for today's lesson.
He died and rose again, set me free.
Welcome to The Liberating Secret. My name is Sylvia Pearce, and I'm so glad to be with you today. I'm in the book of Galatians. I love that little book. It's only 6 chapters, but it's really, really great. And because it brings out a very all-important point about the difference between law and grace. And that really is pertinent in the body of Christ today, because so many of us start out knowing that we're saved by grace alone, by Christ plus nothing. You know, people know that. People know that if you're saved, you have the Lord at all. You know that it wasn't by any of your works. It's nothing that you deserved in order to become a Christian. You just simply put your trust in the Lord Jesus that paid the debt for you at the cross. So we come into salvation. It's Christ plus nothing, just Christ. Christ has done it all. And we praise Him. Our hearts leap with praise because we're understanding for the first time it's a free gift of grace. Well, now the problem comes is as we walk along as Christians, all of a sudden there comes a difference. Something comes up, pops up. All of a sudden we feel like, you know, what can I do now to please God? What can I do? Look what Jesus has done for me. Now what can I do for Him? And so we start thinking of all the things we can do for Him. And then we listen to other people and they say, yes, but if you do, you need to do this and you need to do that. Well, if you're a baby Christian, you really don't know any different. So then all of a sudden, and I'm just telling you my own testimony, I started thinking, now what can I do to serve you, Jesus? I'll try with all my heart to serve you because of what you've done for me. Now that's the fatal point. Now what I've done is I've put myself right back under law. Because grace depends on God and Christ alone and what He has accomplished, and also for the very fact that He has imparted to me His Holy Spirit, who is the life within me, who is the life of Christ within me, you see. So what I'm doing is when I'm going back onto works, then I'm saying, what can I do? Well, we've seen, if you've listened to this program or watched this program, you know that I talk about the difference between what is the human being. The human being is the vessel that contains the God, okay? The human being is a branch, and the life has to come from the vine, and that's John 15. So the Bible is very clear. Jesus Himself is very clear that the power and life has to come from something other than me. So when I start trying to live the Christian life, trying to pay God back, trying to please Him through self-effort, I've just put myself back under law. So that's why this is so important to realize that, and the Bible is continually saying this, and the writer of the Hebrews letter is certainly saying this, there is a rest to the people of God, a place that you can just relax and rest in Him and trust His life inside of you to fulfill the law. I mean, you know, Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy the law. So it's not that the law is not there, it is there. And Romans 7 says the law is good. That's for sure. It is good, and it's right, and it's true. But then how to perform it really is my problem. How to? Well, so there's so many how-tos in Christianity. Well, then, I could pick up a new how-to book almost every day. If I would go to the Christian bookstore, you're just going to find it filled with how-tos. And you see, none of those things really work because I'm depending on the vessel to perform. I'm depending on the branch to be right with God or to maintain my Christian standard before God or to maintain some kind of good feelings that I might hype myself up so that I can feel good all the time. You see, we have to take God at His word. He says that He will come in us and make His abode inside of us, you see. His spirit is joined to my spirit, our spirit, and that's what makes us a Christian. And the new covenant is based on an inner life. It's not based on my performance in order to maintain that inner life. That inner life is maintained by God and God alone. And it's not Christ plus after I become a Christian. I start out with Christ plus nothing when I'm saved. But now that I'm a Christian, it's still not Christ plus me. It's not Christ plus me and what I can do to keep myself in good standing with God. You see, the Holy Spirit does that. My faith in God, in the fact that Christ is my life, He is the one that maintains this life within me. That's not my job. That's God's job. Now, with that Spirit within me, that Holy Spirit within us is going to cause us to want to really know God. Sometimes I think we want to know what God can give us, but we really don't want to know Him. I mean, we love all of His benefits, but you know, God wants us to know Him. He wants us to love Him with all of our hearts. You know what? If I am depending on my own performance, I'm not going to love Him. I'm basically worshiping my own flesh. Wow, I'm not worshiping God. I'm not depending. When I'm depending on Him wholly, I'm telling you, then you will truly worship Him in spirit and in truth. But as Christians, so much of the time, we stumble around simply because we've moved right back into the self effort, trying to please God, trying to maintain our Christian walk through self effort. And that's what Paul is really coming against. Now, the problem in his day was this. The Jews, there were Christians in Jerusalem. And these Christians were still mixed up with a lot of the law because the temple was still there. The temple was destroyed in 70 AD. And this letter was written in about 60 AD. So it was 10 years earlier. So the temple was there. So I'm sure the early Christians, they had Christ, but then they were probably trying to mix, you know, whatever Moses had established for them through the law with their Christian faith. And one thing that they were saying to the young Christians is, if you're really going to be a Christian, you're really going to be saved, and you're really going to please God, you've got to be circumcised. So, of course, we know that was set up through Abraham, you see. And that was certainly the eighth day. Even Jesus was circumcised the eighth day. So that was part of their law. So you see, they were telling the early Christians, you have to be yes, you can have Christ, but it's plus you've got to be circumcised. But see, we do the same thing today. We absolutely do. I mean, there's so many Christians that have so many stipulations on what we have to do. See, when I go back to what do I have to do? Think of it that way. Okay, when I say that, then I'm saying, what does the vessel have to do? Well, that's a good question. The people asked Jesus that in chapter 5 of John. Let's turn back to chapter 5 of John and let's look at that and see what that they asked Jesus that same question. What do we have to do to do the works of God? Okay, this is in it's chapter 6. Chapter 6, and this is what it says, verse 28. Then said they unto him, What shall we do that we might work the works of God? This is how Jesus answered. Jesus said unto them, This is the work of God. There is a work. There is. What is it? That you might believe on him whom he hath sent. This is the work of God. Okay, this is what the vessel is responsible for. This is what the branch is responsible for. Do you realize that faith is just simply the act of receiving what already is, you see, and resting in that truth? That's really all faith is. That's our work. Our work is to simply believe what God says. Okay, if God says, I'm going to put my spirit within you, and I'm going to cause you to walk in my way, and wow, that was taught by Ezekiel back in, even in the Old Testament. You see, grace is really all the way into the Old Testament. Actually, Abraham's was established by grace, by faith. He was made righteous simply by faith, and was declared righteous. You see, so Abraham had a by faith standing with God, but when was he declared righteous? When he went and had his children circumcised? No, he was declared righteous before he did anything. You see, that's the whole point. So you see, Christ is my righteousness. Christ is the one that is the power to live the Christian life within me. Christ is the one that fulfills that law, the law of love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy being, and love thy neighbor as thyself. That's the only New Testament law. Okay, then you might say, how do I do that? It's a good question. It's not how do I do it by self-effort. It has to be the only way I can love is the love within me, which has to be Christ. He is the agape love in me. He is joined to my spirit. So the only way I can truly love God is to have the Holy Spirit within me loving God. It's like God loving God through me, you see. That's the only way that I can actually manifest the fruit of the Spirit, if is His agape love coming through me, because love is really a person. So what do we do to do the works of God? It's always by faith. It's faith is receiving what's already accomplished through the death, burial, and resurrection and glorification of our God, Jesus Christ. You see, that's all we do. We rest in Him. We rest in His life. Well, the early Christians were mixed up. They were mixing law and grace. Now, I've written a little book, and it's called The Difference Between Law and Grace. If you would like that and you like further explanation of the difference between law and grace, then look on my website and you'll see that little book. You can pull it off free, or if you would like it in your hand, you can write me and I'll send it to you. So why do we harp so on this point? And why do we emphasize this point? Well, we emphasize this point is because Paul had to emphasize it, because there was a transition between the old and the new. There was a transition. And the new Christians were so readily put right back under the law. And actually, in chapter 2 of Galatians, Paul came down strong on Peter, because Peter was a part of dividing the new church there in Antioch. And actually, it was the devil trying to divide the church in Antioch. Okay, Paul had established this church years earlier, and Peter came there, and we're going to read this in Galatians chapter 2, but he was with the early Christians there, and they were eating together. Well, if you remember, in the old covenant, you were never supposed to eat pork. That was established through Moses. Okay, now grace and truth came through Jesus Christ, and so now Peter is in Christ. And he's sitting there with the new, with the early new Christians there in Antioch, and they were still babes, you see, so they could be persuaded one way or the other because they were not established Christians yet. And so they the Christ in them had not been established inside of them. Now, he is there, but we have to come to the understanding and the knowledge of him being inside of us to be established. So they were just beginners, you see, and he was eating, probably a lot of people say he was eating pork chops. Well, the thing that happened is he heard that some of his brothers from Jerusalem who were still under the law were coming to Antioch. And all of a sudden, he gets afraid, like, oh my gosh, they're going to see me eating pork, and they don't believe in that, and they're going to discredit me. Now think about it. He had a great reputation. Peter was, oh my goodness, he was a powerful apostle. And he had great reputation among the people, and he was revered, and everybody trusted, you know, him. And there he was thinking, he was worrying about his own reputation. And so he thought, what are they going to think of me if I'm sitting here eating pork with the early Christians? I don't know what they're going to think, and they're going to discredit me. So he was in fear of what the other Christians would say to him. He jumps up from the table. Well, everybody thinks, well, what's wrong? And then they realize that he thinks he can't eat that pork because of the other Christians coming. Well, you see, what that did was it confused everybody. And they thought, well, we thought that we could do this. Are you telling us now we're not supposed to eat pork? You see? And it was going to put them right back under law, the dietary law, not just circumcision, but now dietary. I'm telling you, the minute you add one law, you might as well add two, and then three, and then four, and then five. It will continue, it will multiply, and then it will multiply upon itself. You see, that's exactly how performance is. Performance is not, because you're never going to be satisfied if you're depending on yourself to live the Christian life. You're never going to be satisfied if you're depending on what others might think about you. I mean, maybe people think, well, you can't be that free. Well, if I was that free, then you're going to go out and sin. You're going to do terrible, wrong things. Well, you're not depending on the keeping power of God. See, faith, we're believing in the invisible life of Christ within us because God said it, because we're taking God at His word. He has said it. He said, and so the only way to be established and to be a fixed Christian, and God wants fixation in Christians. He wants settlement. He wants us settled, you see. Then, so if somebody comes and tries to persuade us, well, you've got to do this and you've got to do that in order to maintain your Christian life or be right with God, you see, we can say, well, bless you, but that's not what the Bible is telling me, and that's not what God is telling me. But you see, and I've had plenty of people say that to me. One time I had a person say to me, you're feeding people poison. And, you know, and I said to them, well, that's anything's possible. I'll just have to take it before God. I said, I don't believe that. I'm saying exactly what the Bible is saying. I mean, giving people freedom in Christ when God Himself says that I will put you into Christ and you will be free indeed. How can that be poison? How can that be poison? You see, it's not. It's liberation. It's poison when we continually put the shoulds and oughts back on to our humanity to fulfill the Christian life. That's why so many Christians are defeated in the first place, because we're not understanding the fullness of the gospel, that we not only have Christ that forgives us of our sins, but He also has imparted to us His very life. That is eternal life. It's not something I'm going to get when I die. Actually, Christ is that life. He that hath the Son has eternal life. So the Son is eternal life. Life is a person. It's Christ Himself. And so without knowing Christ within, which is our only hope of glory, we're going to be depending on ourselves. And we're going to be trying and striving in order to stay right with God, to maintain our Christian standard or pump up our feelings so that we can feel closer to God. How can you be any closer when He has joined Himself to you? See, we always think of God as being far off when we've got to get closer to Him. Well, the truth is He got so close to us, He joined Himself to our spirit. So you can't get any closer than that. You have to recognize what already is. The whole point of faith is just to take and receive what God has already provided through the Lord Jesus Christ. We have a great inheritance. We have a mighty inheritance. It's freely given to us. You know, one of the verses I love is in Isaiah 55. Let me read you this verse. This is a wonderful verse because it really says exactly what I'm saying. This is right in the Old Testament. You see, God's always been full of grace and mercy. Always. It's just that He had to prepare mankind through history, giving mankind the law, which is the first forms of grace and love, because God can be nothing but grace and love and mercy. So how can law be the first forms? Well, the Old Testament promises us of a Savior. So it's full of the promises, the messianic promises of the Savior. Well, we have to be prepared to know that we're sinners. We have to know that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God, you see, before we can really receive the Savior. So the Old Testament, God kind of did a trick because He gave us all the law. He said, okay, now I'm going to give you this way to be right with me, but it's going to be legal. It's going to be through striving to do the right thing. Well, you see, we see the pattern of the Old Testament. Why didn't they live right? Well, they couldn't. They kept continually falling into apostasy. Why? Because they were trying to strive to keep themselves. So why are Christians falling into apostasy? It's only because we're trying to do it ourselves. Now, even in the Old Testament, so God had to prove to the Old Testament saints that it's not by might nor by power, but by God. God is your Savior. God is your keeper. God is your provider. Christ is all and in all of us as saints. Okay, so Isaiah 55, verse 1. Lo, every man that thirst, come ye to the waters. And he that hath no money, come on, come ye. Buy and eat, yea, come. Buy wine and milk, without money and without price. Wow. You see, the milk of the Word, the Lord Jesus Christ, is the sweet wine and the sweet waters and the milk. You see, He is our all in all. And He's freely given to us by faith. So, we began this lesson by saying that we all began by Jesus plus nothing, just receiving Him, and we are in joy and praise and grace because we know Him. But as soon after we know Him, we're put under law. So, and we're put under what I have to do in order to perform. And basically, why do we think that? If we didn't have other people telling us what to do, why do we think that way? We think that way because through our fallen condition, we have a mentality of seeing separation. We don't see oneness. You see, there is only one body in Christ. There is only oneness. You see, all is really one. Okay, well, because we don't see that, we don't know that our own oneness with Christ. And because we don't know that we're one with Christ, we see separation. And in seeing this separation, it's caused us to think that somehow separate from God, now I can perform and I can be right with God and I can do the right thing. I can do it. I can do it. I can do it. It's like the little train that says, I can do it. I can do it. I can do it. I can do it. That's going to be sure failure. That's going to be failure to every one of us that are trying to live the Christian life by our shoulds and oughts, are adding one thing to the gospel. It's Jesus plus nothing. It's Jesus died for my sins plus nothing. It's Jesus come into my life and inside of me plus nothing. And what do I do then to work the works of God? I simply believe on Him. believe that He has come inside, that He has transformed me, He's made me a new creation, and I can get to really understand this inner life within. See, so many of the time we're walking as if we're just outer people. And so we're experiencing our what we think and what we feel is more real to us than the inner man of the heart. We need to learn how to walk in the spirit of who we really are, walk in the inner man of who we are, and understand that is the true reality. How we think and how we feel is only our human response to usually to some outer stimuli, something that's stimulating us, causing us to either fear or we're having some kind of human reaction about something. Well, that's my human reactions. But who are we really? Well, we're really, you see, we have Christ within us who is my peace, who is, see, peace is a person also. Eternal life is a person. Power is a person. The power to live the Christian life is the person himself. Life, eternal life is the person of Jesus himself. He that hath the Son hath life, you see. We're making it a thing. We're making it separate from us. We're making Christ separate from us. We even say, let him walk beside me and help me. He's not going to walk beside you and help you. He is the life within you. Now, we have got to get to know that as Christians. Without that, we're always going to be babes. We're going to be carnal. We're going to be shaken. Every wind of doctrine that comes is going to shake us off. We're going to be more flesh-minded than we are spirit-minded. We're not going to have the single eye of faith or the trauma, the traumatic things that happen to us daily or weekly or monthly are going to affect us to the point that it defeats us because we're living a life as if we're separate from Christ. That's a lie. We're not separate. If you've received Him, you are one with Him. Now, that's what Jesus said when in John 17, that was his last prayer before he was crucified. He prayed to his Father that we might know the same union relationship that he knew with his Father and we could operate the same way he operated. That's why in John 15, before he goes to the cross, he tells his disciples, without me you can do nothing because you're only a branch. The human being is the branch, not the vine. And I'm the vine. You're the branch. Without me, you can do nothing. Okay, so we get to know that the power is within us when we feel weak. When we feel confused, the clarity is within us because He is our life. So thank you, and we're going to continue talking about grace. We cannot talk about this enough. This is an all-important subject. So thank you for joining me, and may God richly bless you. Goodbye.
You have been listening to The Liberating Secret with Sylvia Pearce. We want to send a special thank you to all our supporters who make this program possible. If you have been blessed by this program and would like to contact Sylvia, you can write her at P.O. Box 43268, Louisville, Kentucky, 40253. That's Post Office Box 43268, Louisville, Kentucky, 40253. You can also find more of Sylvia's teachings on her website. The web address is www.theliberatingsecret.com. That's www.theliberatingsecret.com. And be sure to listen again right here, Monday through Friday at the same time, for The Liberating Secret with author and teacher Sylvia Pearce. So until next time, may God richly bless you.